So we did not practice this in advance. Thank you very much. I'm still wondering why everybody has so much problems with my last name and the pronunciation of
how
the
is it,
name. Uit de Haag. So if you simply translate it into French, it's easy. De La Haye. De La Haye in French. Or Jos. That's much easier. Jos. That's Vol. No. I'm sorry for that, but if I have to do it in French, it's as well, it's not as bad as my Portuguese, but it's everybody would run away, I think. I'm going to say something. I will speak slowly. Maybe that's easier for the translators than no, it's not easier. Okay. I would like to focus rather than on, let's say, how to perform the statement of facts. I would like to concentrate on the value of the statement of facts, and especially the statement of fact as it is produced by the public officer, being either a notary or, in my case, in your case, the judicial officer, the enforcement agent, because there's quite a difference. I mean, in generally, everybody can make a statement of fact. That's easy. But the value of a statement of fact, if it is done by anybody else, even an inspector of an insurance company, as we were discussing during the lunch break, the value is completely different if such a statement of fact is performed by a public officer. So by a notary or by a enforcement agent. I would like to start with this. I'm sorry, because I know that we have a lawyer in the panel, but this is what was happening in France about 10 years ago. This was in August 2009. And in August 2009, and you see some drafts from the publications that were done that time. Le Figaro in France said that Sarkozy was busy with the development of a legal base of what he called the l'acte contrasigné par un avocat. So he was that way introducing a new instrument. And okay, finally, that instrument was also adopted in French legislation in October 2011. It was also adopted. Why is this act, why is this interesting? Because it is completely different. The position of a lawyer, if you talk about an act, or the position of a public officer as the enforcement agent. So you can have several questions in that respect. The first question in that respect is, why should a lawyer be involved in the establishment of such an act? Of course, discussions on that topic also in France, mainly fettered by the enforcement agents, the Vichy Justice at that time, and by the notaries. But then the question also arises, why should not, or how to value the power and how to formulate an act if it is done by a public officer? Because after all, as a public officer, we are given certain powers to produce, as we call them then, authentic acts. A good example of such an authentic act is the statement of facts. In a number of countries, we see that this statement of facts is a mandatory activity, which is also regulated by law. And in that respect, I would like to focus, for example, also on guideline, CEPES guideline number 34, CEPES guideline, CEPES, the Commission for the Efficiency of Justice from the Council of Europe. In this guideline 34, guidelines on enforcement, they explicitly mention as a secondary activity for the enforcement agent, the producing of a statement of facts. So they also acknowledge the importance of the statement of fact and the fact that the enforcement agent should be involved in that as one of the main persons. We see that back also in a lot of legislation. In a lot of legislation, in a lot of countries, you see that the statement of fact is a mandatory activity regulated by law. I said already, any individual can make such a statement of fact. There's nothing wrong with that. However, there has to be given a certain value when the statement of fact is done by us, enforcement agents, solicitadores, procuradores, or enforcement executores. As you are calling them. So whatever name they have all one thing in common. They are a public officer. And as a public officer, it means that this act has, as an authentic act, has a valid of proof. Of course, unless otherwise stated by another enforcement agent who is going against it. So what is a statement of fact as an authentic act? I think we can define, and okay, I've took a bit the liberty of looking in different parts of legislation, but you see some common familiarities if we talk about the statement of fact. First, the statement of fact is a written act made by a public officer, meaning a notary or an enforcement agent, solicitadores, that can be used as evidence in civil and commercial matters of material facts observed by such an enforcement agent personally. So you see a number of things coming back. It can be written, it has to be personally observed, it has to refer to material facts. Honestly, we have done training in statement of facts in a lot of countries, and especially is very complicated for people that are starting with the writing of statement of facts, observed material facts, so no conclusions. It's strictly focusing on facts and facts only. Conclusions is something that has to be done by the court, has to be done by the parties, or has to be done by their lawyers. Well, as mentioned, the probative effect. So let's have a closer look at the probative effect of the statement of facts. A probative effect is coming from the fact that it is done by a public officer in a form, as Dutch law, for example, is also saying, in a form as prescribed by law, within a certain legal competence, which is also important, of that person. And that legal competence gives this person, gives the act, a certain authenticity. All those things are very much of importance. If you look at the characteristics of the statement of facts, or statement of fact by the enforcement agent, well, it has... as an authentic act, it has a greater probative value than a private agreement. The judge, that means that the judge, also in Dutch law, for example, must accept such an act as a probative and its probative value. It makes proof of the contents of such an act against all persons until set aside by a special procedure. And there we see a familiarity already also with the fact that we are enforcement agents, because we are liable. So we are liable also on the contents of such an act. So we will be very careful in what we will be writing down in such an act, because if the result of such a special procedure is the fact that it can be set aside, it means that party or one of the parties will hold us liable. It means also the authentic act. If one of the parties starts denying, for example, also the signature, and the act has to prove, this party has to prove the authenticity. Another issue is that there's clarity on the identification of the parties, at least in certain statement of facts. Honestly, it is an issue that I think in future will become more and more important, because if you talk about material facts, but I think in future where there is a huge possibility for the statement of facts is what we see now the last years in the IT developments. I mean, everybody is talking, it's a hype about blockchains, everybody is talking about smart contracts, everybody is involved or wants to be involved in that issues, especially if you talk about blockchains, if you talk about smart contracts, this identification of parties will become more and more important. How you can identify those persons, or whom should identify those persons. Honestly, I think there is a very important task for the enforcement agent and a huge opportunity for the enforcement agent there to be involved. And how do we do that? I would say we do that in the form of an authentic act. We do that in the form of a statement of facts. With an authentic act, with its probative value also. Such an act, authentic act, also gives clarity with regard to the date of the act. It gives clarity, and then, okay, we look at another authentic act, the notarial act. It gives clarity, for example, about the debt or the claim that we are talking about. You see, in a lot of countries, again, the value of somebody being a public officer, we see notarial acts as an enforceable title, an enforceable document. Why? Why is this power given to notaries? Because as we are, they are also public officers. For some legal transactions, then again with regard to the notaries, a notarial act, authentic act, is obligatory. The advantage of an authentic act is also, it is not necessary to ratify or to confirm it by the court. So familiarities with regard to the authentic act, and most of those familiarities also refer to the statement of facts as we are able to produce them. At the same time, there are some questions I think you can ask yourself. First, with regard to the privacy, which is very much of importance, of course, and we have this new legislation on a European level with regard to data protection. It becomes more and more important. But we have to consider what is the use. Why do we need this statement of facts? Should it become a public document? Should it remain a private document? Should it be a document only between parties, or should it have a broader extent? Another question with regard to the statement of facts, not honestly very well regulated in a lot of countries, is with regard to the location of the statement of facts. Also, the statement of facts are combined with the privacy aspect, because if I have to do a statement of facts, for example, in a shop that is selling illegal products or falsified products, should I identify myself if I enter such a shop? And should I say to the shop owner or to the staff in the shop, my name is Jos Uitenaar, I'm an enforcement agent, I'm here for a statement of fact or for this and this reason. But should I not do that? Here I think it's very much of importance that there is clear legislation. What are the rights? And do I have certain rights? Or do I first have to go to court and ask for an enforceable title, an enforceable document, in order to be able to carry out such an statement of facts. There, legislation is very much of importance, I think. And then the third issue or question is what is the value of the statement of fact, the judicial statement? Is it indeed, can it be ordered, or can an enforcement be ordered, an enforcement agent, for example, be ordered by court to produce a statement of facts? Some countries, yes. For example, in France, it is possible that the court orders an enforcement agent to carry out a statement of facts. But you also have a lot of countries where still this is not regulated by law. Or it is indirectly regulated by law. For example, if I take as an example my own country, we have since several years, we have the possibility of an attachment in order to safeguard evidence. They call it an attachment, but in fact what you are doing is a statement of facts based as a provisional measure, based on the order of a court, the president of the court of first instance. So what is the role of the enforcement agent if you talk about the statement of facts? Well, first of all, it is important that we are legal professionals. That very much is of importance. Just to come back to the example that I was mentioning with regard to smart contracts, with regard to blockchain, I mean, next to the identification of parties, there it is becoming more and more important that those parties not only can be identified, but also that we can put in the statement of facts that we have shown those parties what are their rights and obligations. This is becoming, I think, more and more important. Why? If you talk about blockchain, if you talk about smart contracts, in general, even if you talk about online buying and selling, geographical borders are disappearing. But with the disappearance of geographical borders, a lot of security, legal protection, there's a chance that this legal protection, especially if we talk about the weaker parties, is also disappearing. Again, I think there is an important task in future for the enforcement agent. So not only the moment that somebody wants to go into a smart contract or wants to go into a, we are talking about private blockchain then, it is also important that besides the identification, we can also state in our statement of facts that we have shown these parties on their rights and obligations. I mean, I can buy goods, I can buy them in Amazon. Well, nowadays Amazon is in most European countries, but I can order also goods with Alibaba, and Alibaba is the Amazon of China. And how does a consumer with regard to Alibaba knows about their rights and protection under Chinese law, if at all Chinese law is applicable there. So it's important that it is done by a legal professional, legal advisor, and it is important that I think that it is done by an independent person, meaning a public officer, as said already. Because as a public officer, we are supposed to be impartial, and we are giving legal advices as we do the same in enforcement. We give the advices to the debtor and we give the advices to the creditor, and both are of importance for us. We are not a representative of only one party. We have to represent both parties and we have to look for the balance. I think the same applies also if we talk about statement of facts. Meaning, for example, also this statement of facts that we do it at the request of one party, but we define, we write the statement of facts from our independent position. So we're not going to write down in a statement of facts what the party asked me to do so. That's also not the observance of material facts, of course. So that very much, well, I already mentioned the role of the enforcement agent if we talk about the verification of the identity, verification of the capacity, verification of the authority, but also the verification of the signatures of parties to a certain act. Maybe smart contract. The enforcement agent ensures that parties have been properly informed about the legal consequences of the act to be signed, and they guarantee also that the consent has been given freely. Again, this is important also. I mean, the moment that something is put, for example, I come back every time to the blockchain because I see a lot of future in developments in that respect and the task that we have in that respect. The moment that we are in a blockchain, and at that moment, nothing can be done anymore. It is yes or no, it's black or white in the blockchain. No changes are possible there. So then it is good also to know in advance that that there is a guarantee, or a guarantee can be given with regard to the consents, and the fact that these consents are being given free, showing the parties on their rights and obligations in that respect. So if we talk about the Authentic Act, and if we talk about our position, I said already, we act as a public officer. We have to respect principles of equality and accessibility. Also, if the statement of facts is done at the request of one of the parties. Another example with regard to the statement of facts by the enforcement agent is, I think, that it is a public service, but the public service is based on a certain fixed price, normally, at least. The statement of facts is part of the fee schedule that also refers, for example, to the enforcement cases. Another example of the statement of facts by the enforcement agent is the fact that there is a detailed system of monitoring and control. If it is called BFT, as the name of the monitoring and control body is in Netherlands, or it's called CAI in Portugal, or it's whatever name it is, but we are subject of monitoring and control for all the activities that we are performing, so including also the statement of facts. And by your own profession, as it is the chamber in Portugal, as it is the chamber in Netherlands or in Spain, they are also controlling us. Another advantage, we have an obligation to perform official acts when requested. Only in those cases, if there is a conflict of interest, if I have to make a statement of facts on a family member, for example, then I have an excuse, I can apologize myself. But otherwise, I am, the same as with regard to enforcement, I am obliged to carry out an enforcement request. I am also obliged then, in that case, to carry out a statement of facts. Important also, another a particularity, I would say, is the personal liability that we have. We have a personal liability. Liability insurance is obliged. We have a personal liability with regard to enforcement. But that personal liability also refers to the statement of facts. So if we do something wrong, if we do not put in a correct way, in a correct manner, the contents of the statement of facts, we will be held liable for that. Financially, so civil, criminally, and disciplinary liability also refers to the statement of facts. Another issue of importance is the certainty about the date, or even the certainty, I would say, not only about the date, but also about the time of the statement of facts. If I state that it is today at the 10th of July, it is done, what time is it, 15:23, the statement of facts was done, as said, being an authentic act, there's no discussion on this topic. And that makes it also different from the acts of other persons. So I think, or I hope to have shown you that the statement of facts is very much of importance also if we talk about the probative effect of the statement of fact, but that also means, as said already, that there needs to be a very clear legislative framework a legislative framework that focuses also that the enforcement agent is producing the statement of facts based on the particularity, that he is neutral, that he is impartial, that he is objective, and that he is unbiased with regard to his performance. All those things are then very much of importance. As said, focus only on material facts and not focusing on what one of the parties wants you to write down in the statement of facts. Well, very quickly, because I already mentioned this, the changing working environment of the enforcement agent, I see a statement of facts not only as it is done presently, if we talk about going to a shop on falsified products, or we are witnessing destroyance of a party of goods at the request of an insurance company, or with regard to construction and building. But I see a huge future for the statement of facts as an authentic act also in the IT environment. As said already, blockchain needs also that the integrity of the blockchain is ensured. And that means that this integrity, if you talk about the support, if you talk about the identity, if you talk about the contents of the information, or even if you talk about the process of conservation, the storing of electronic data, I see there a huge future for us, or an additional activity for us as enforcement agents. That's it. I'm sorry I took too much time, but I hope you all understand my my version of Portuguese language.
Yeah, I think so. Thank you very much.